And for this today's topic on RE applications, occurrence, exploration, and chemical characterization, which will be delivered by Dr. V. Balaram. So before going to that, I'll just tell you about a little bit about who are DataCore. And so basically, we are committed partners of industry. We have DataCore is a leading organization in the field of geoscience industry, bringing cutting edge technology and services to the industry. And we have more than 25 years of experience in this industry. And we have a very good existing relationship with all maximum people in the field of geosciences. We have global partners along with us, and we have international clients, and we believe in the mantra of CE, which is empowerment of end users, enhancement of employee skill set, and equity of all stakeholders. Now, a little bit about Partner in Progress. This is a newly initiated team which we are starting from today. So this is going to be one of the first webinar, and there will be a lot of webinar on different subjects which will be coming up in this very theme of Partner in Progress. So main objective here is to share knowledge with the community for better reach of the subjects. And we are aiming to bring eminent speakers. Like today, we are obliged with Dr. V. Balaram, sir. These sessions will be online and free sessions. It will be open to all, and it will happen once in every month, and we will try to keep it in every second Saturday so that everyone can attend. And now, who should attend this? I think everyone should attend. All personnel, all students and professionals from the industry should attend this. Our main goal from this Partner in Progress is to empower students and professionals from the industry, and to create a wealth of knowledge for the society at large. Now, about today's speaker, Dr. V. Balaram, sir. He is former emeritus scientist, chief scientist, and head geochemistry division in CSIR, National Geophysics Research Institute, Hyderabad. At present, he is project consulting scientist, and he is also included in Stanford University's new list of the top 2% scientists in the world in 2020. So, sir, we are very very much obliged to have you here, and a warm welcome to you. And over to you, sir. You can present your slides, and we will try to get some knowledge out of your presentation today. Thank you, sir. Over to you, sir.
Okay, thank you so much. Yeah, first of all, I have to thank Mr. Karunakar Rao garu, the founder president of DataCore, and other colleagues, Dhruv Jyotinath, vice president, Vikas Piru, principal, and Mr. Abhishek Sen is a senior GIS analyst. So they invited me, and it's an opportunity to share my knowledge, whatever little I have, with all our colleagues who are interested in this. And my interest in today's talk on rare earth elements, my interest in rare earth elements goes back to nearly 30 years, because when we were handling a project on origin of life, of course, my senior colleague, Dr. Naqvi, initiated that project, and in that project there was a great need to understand the redox potential, paleo redox potentials, at what geological time oxygen was available, at what those things. So these rare earth elements were redox sensitive, so we made a big case to obtain rare earth element data by ICP-MS. Until that time, we were depending on the scarce data which we were getting by neutron activation analysis. So luckily, the DST, Department of Science and Technology, gave us this ICP-MS instrument in 1987. That was the first instrument in the country, whole country, and fourth in Asia. At the time, there were only two in Japan, one in China in Beijing, the fourth one in India in Hyderabad at NGRI. So that was the starting. Then until that time, rare earth element data was somewhat not reachable. Then we made it very reachable. We not only developed procedures for the precise rare earth elements in geological samples, maybe it is rocks, it's sediments, water, whatever. And then we left and right developed procedures to accurately determine rare earth elements. And not only we used it to our projects, we also helped a lot of others in this country. One of the senior scientists said there is a diarrhea of rare earth elements in the country today. It's a long time back, he said. So that kind of a situation. Of course, in addition to we really never did any serious rare earth element exploration studies, but we did the serious exploration studies in gold, not only in India, in Karnataka, Rajasthan, and also outside Madagascar also we did in collaboration with NMDC. In fact, we identified some zones for the drilling for gold. We also did a lot of exploration studies in Bundelkhand area in Tamil Nadu, few other areas in the country for platinum group elements also. We also have a fire cell laboratory for the precise determination of platinum group elements at NGRI, and we are not only helping ourselves, but we are also helping lots of other people. So with this few initial remarks, I will get into my talk. So the title is Rare Earth Elements Applications, Occurrences, Exploration and Chemical Characterization. Today, the geosciences assume a lot of importance in not only in mineral exploration, but also several areas like energy, water, waste disposal, natural hazards, climate change, which is the current crisis these days, and many more. So geosciences assumes a lot of importance. And if you look at the global mining projects all over the country, not only rare earth elements, but also a lot of all other elements, including rare earths, of course. And you can see the clusters. Of course, America, Canada, then in South America, particularly in Chile, those countries, and also China. Of course, India is also not lagging behind Africa and some of the Asian countries, Middle East, those countries. In fact, if you look at the China's investment, it's really mind-boggling. So, and if you look at the situation of the mineral reserves for the entire world, there are actually very few mineral-rich countries like Russia, Canada, United States, Australia, and South Africa. And our country falls under specific minerals. For example, rare earth elements, manganese, coal, iron ore, etc. We are rich in those minerals. But in general, Russia, Canada, United States, South Africa, and Australia, probably China, because China dominates in the mineral sector these days. And if you look at there is a diagram which I gave in my 2019 paper. We have developed this diagram on the basis of the supply risk, environmental implications, vulnerability to supply restrictions. So you can see that rare earth elements are very much there in this particular supply risk. It means there is a lot of demand and people are not able to meet the demand. And today, if you look at the applications, the computer hard drives, hard drive, disk drive motors, anti-lock brakes, then automotive parts, frictionless bearings, magnetic refrigeration, microwave power tubes, microphones and speakers, communications, MRI, LED lights, and then batteries. All these electric cars which are coming now have the nickel metal hydride batteries, in which the rare earth elements play a lot of importance, particularly in petroleum refining. And more importantly, the permanent magnets made of rare earth are used in these windmills, which are producing lots of gigawatts of energy for the people these days. And then electronics. And one interesting aspect is the rare earth elements are used to make colors now. This was a rare discovery by, I know this man is Professor Subramaniam from Oregon State University. They were not interested in the paints. They were interested in preparing the special electronic materials. They have actually put yttrium, indium and manganese, and then heated at some 1150 degrees centigrade in a furnace, and looking for a special material with very special qualities, particularly related to the electronics. But to their surprise, they found a brilliant gray blue compound, which later on they found that it can be used as a paint, which never fades. It doesn't fade with ordinary paints, you know, they fade within 1 year or 2 years, but this particular paint doesn't fade. So that is called yttrium indium MN blue. So they, later on, they have created whole range of different colors in the yttrium indium MN blue series, including purple, green, yellow, orange, by adding new elements. This is one of the interesting lectures and interesting aspects of the rare earth elements. I met this gentleman who is the inventor along with his students in the International Conference on Rare Earth Elements sometime back in SV University, Tirupati. So the current applications dominate magnets, catalysts, and then polishing. And there are other like batteries, which I have, glass, magnets, metallurgy, then phosphors, then polishing, etc. And today we have lots of operating mines for rare earth elements. And because of the competition from China, and China is able to supply at a cheaper rate. So as a result, our companies were really struggling to survive. And these are some of the companies in the government sector, the Indian Rare Earths Limited, Alua, and Chavra in Kerala. And there is one in Tamil Nadu, and there is one in Orissa. And there is one Kerala Minerals and Metals Limited in the private, and VV Minerals. These are some of the, but this is not the exhaust list. But now, worldwide, lots of companies, particularly in Africa, Namibia, South Africa, Kenya, Madagascar, Burundi, etc., lots of rare earth companies are there, which are working very hard to take out the rare earth elements from their crust. And if you look at the rare earth reserves, the estimated reserves are 120 million tons all over the world, with China leading with 38% of the reserves, and followed by followed by Russia, Brazil. Of course, India has 6%. And today, mine production is about 240,000 tons. Even here, China dominates again, followed by United States and Brazil. And if you look at the deposits, various kinds of deposits, you know, the carbonatites and alkaline igneous rocks are the major deposits of the rare earth elements. The largest known carbonatite related RE deposits in Bayanobo, a region of the Inner Mongolia, China, It has produced about 97% of the global output of RE. Even in India, Ambadavangar carbonatite complex, the first carbonatite discovery in India in 1963, with its rich fluoride deposit, it is supposed to contain over 10 million tons of resources. And there are a lot of other complexes in India that have been explored for rare earth resources since 1970s. The carbonatites and alkaline igneous rocks are characteristically found in interiors of the plate, interiors of the tectonic plates, not in the boundaries. And there is also another theory that the many carbonatite complexes worldwide are spatially and temporarily associated with mantle plume originated large igneous provinces. For example, Ambadavangar. The other examples include Mountain Pass, California, China's Bayanobo, Itterby of Sweden, the Kamathi, Rajasthan, and these are some of the well-known deposits. And if you look at the concentration of rare earth elements, for example, average concentration from carbonatite from Khadarpet near Vajrakarur, you see the lanthanum 1350, and then cerium 2000, more than 2000 ppm, and sigma 4500, means the total RE 4500 ppm. So the carbonatites are really very rich in rare earth elements. And other than carbonatites, there are pegmatites which also are enriched, particularly in apatites. Then iron oxide copper gold deposits contain larger amounts of rare earth elements as well as uranium. Wien and skarn deposits, the RE mineral concentrations of economic interest in granite pegmatite and some hydrothermal Wien systems. Some skarn deposits contain economically very high concentrations of RE and uranium. In fact, these are some of the books. You see, for example, I have written a paper in 1999 for, again, Dr. Krishnamurthy of AMD also written a very good paper. Then Dr. Imuna Singh of AMD wrote a book, in fact. So now in 2029, I'm coming out with a book chapter, which is being published by the University of Ireland. Coming to these are the primary deposits: carbonatites, pegmatites, iron oxide, copper gold deposits. Wien and skarn deposits are the primary deposits. The secondary deposits are the residual deposits such as laterites, iron absorption clays, and placer deposits. The residual deposits are formed from the deep weathering of igneous rocks, pegmatites, iron oxide, copper gold deposits. And most of the primary deposits, when they are weathered, so you get the residual deposits. The laterite deposits results in the enrichment of rare earth elements in situ chemical alteration. The iron absorption type are formed by the subtropical weathering of igneous rocks. The depending upon the source of the erosion products, certain rare earth bearing minerals such as monazite, genotime can be concentrated along with other heavy minerals such as ilmenite, rutile, magnetite, and zircon. For examples include tin-rich river placers in Malaysia, paleo placers in Witwatersrand in South Africa, and then Elliot Lake in Ontario, and then beach sand deposits of Kerala, Tamil Nadu, Orissa of India. So in fact, India has the third largest resource of hard rock and beach sand RE and RE resources. And then there are also, other than primary and secondary, there are also alternate RE resources, which I have highlighted in my 2019 paper. And for exploration, in general, 300 ppm of total RE is the cutoff. So what are the RE, alternate RE resources? Coal and coal fly ash. So the world coal ash Average of world coal ash rare earth content is about 400. It's much higher than the cutoff grade. Means coal and coal fly ash are very significant for RE exploration. Then ocean bottom sediments. The ocean floor sediments contain sigma, the total RE concentrations as high as 22,000 ppm from the Pacific Ocean. And we from our NGRI, we had a collaborative project with NIO and NCAOR, now that is NCPOR. We explored, so the cobalt crust samples, the marine sediments, for their rare earth element content as well as PG content in the Afanasia nicotine seamount in the eastern equatorial Indian Ocean. We reported values ranging anywhere between 1,727 to 2,500 in the Indian Ocean. So this is going to be, once you exhaust the land resources, we have to look forward to the ocean resources. So this is the, at least for the time being, this is the kind of inventory we have for RE. Then the next important is phosphorite deposits. Phosphorites generally have considerable amount of RE, and somewhere around between 314 to 289. For example, the North African, Tunisian and Algerian phosphorites exhibits an average of this much. And RE in river sediments also. Recently we found, in fact, I have incorporated in this book chapter, the Himalayan and Amazon river sediments are showing sigma RE anywhere between 152 to 217. Now with the cutoff grade 300, probably they are not useful at the moment, but in future, we don't know. The kind of technology we have, the cutoff grade can go down and depending upon the demand. And then waste rock sources from the old and closed mines. Because these waste rocks are already there, you don't have to mine that. And they contain significant concentrations of rare earth elements. And then the last one is red mud. Red mud is a waste product from the Bayer process of producing aluminum oxide from bauxite. That is generated at a rate of 175.5 million tons per year. So already the global stockpile of red mud is near 4 billion tons. And the RE concentrations can go up to anywhere between 500 to 1700 ppm. So this is going to be a very big resource for rare earth elements. So now it's an interesting aspect, but somebody predicted that the current resources of rare earth elements are only sufficient for 2500 years. Then afterwards, where from you get your rare earth elements? So you need to look at extraterrestrial RE resources. So Moon, Mars, chondrite, meteorites, etc., that have been characterized to create, provide crucial insights into the differentiation history of the planetary objects. Current and future missions to Moon, Mars, and other nearby objects in our solar system may yet reveal one more extraterrestrial RE resources that one day will be utilized. And people are already started. You see, only few days back, we are seeing that people, the six people have gone to the space on a flight, and nothing is impossible. And there is the reason, there is one Mr. Naveen Jain who started a company called Moon Express. The ultimate aim is to explore Moon. After all, the Moon was once the part of the Earth and was ejected in the early history of the solar system. Thus, it is likely that some of the ores and minerals we have here also present on the Moon. So already some experiments are going on extraction of rare earth elements in space with microbes. In fact, they have taken the basaltic rocks from the Earth on the space in the space laboratory, and they are trying to see with the help of microbes the efficiency of extraction under microgravity, Mars gravity, and Earth gravity. You can see that you see the microgravity is a non-biological control. Microgravity in fact gives more extraction with biological control. They could not come to a certain any particular decision whether it is useful or not, but the experiments are going on. See, for your the gravity on the Earth is 9.8. Gravity on Mars is 3.7. Microgravity is almost like no gravity. The space where people just float. So there, that is the microgravity condition. And this is a cartoon showing the mineral exploration of Moon. Very recently, the 8 nations led by US have signed, the countries Australia, Canada, Japan, Luxembourg, Italy, UK, UAE, of course, and US. They have a program called Artemis program. The Artemis aims to land 2 astronauts near the lunar South Pole in 2024 and establish a sustainable human presence on around Moon by the end of this decade. Bold goals that NASA aims to achieve with the help of international and private sector partnerships. So nothing is impossible, and we might see RE exploration in Moon very soon. And the another very important resource is recycling, because already, even for example, our laptops, our cell phones, they contain lots of rare earth elements, and which we are throwing after their use, after the end of their life time. So it is extremely meet the growing demand for rare earth elements, as most of the production is located only in few countries like China, US, Australia, and India. On the other hand, mountains of about 50 million tons of tons per year of e-waste rich in RE and other precious metals like platinum, gold, etc. We are throwing, and it's in fact, it's piling up across the globe. And the people are thinking of turning this valuable waste into resources. In fact, very recently, a lot of research is going on developing the procedures for the cost-effective recovery. The Apple, in fact, made a robo which can process about 1 lakh iPhones per hour. If you process 1 lakh iPhone in 1 hour, you get 1,900 kilograms of aluminum, 770 kilograms of cobalt, 710 kilograms of copper, 93 kilograms of tungsten. These are all valuable. And 42 kilograms of tin, 11 kilograms of REE, 7.5 kilograms of silver, 1.5 kilograms of tantalum, and about a kilogram of gold, and about 0.1 kilogram of palladium. So that is the kind of value this recycling has. A lot of research is going on. To sum up, the RE resources can be divided into 2 categories, and of course, primarily the primary RE deposits like carbonatites, igneous rock, alkaline igneous rocks, pegmatites, iron oxide, copper gold deposits, VN and skarn deposits. And then secondary deposits like residual deposits, laterite, ion absorption clays, and placer deposits. Then third is offshore sources like phosphorites, and then ferromanganese crust, manganese nodules, and also marine mud. And then RE in coal, as I said, is also a valuable deposit, resource rather. RE in waste rock from the old and closed mines. Then we also discussed about the extraterrestrial RE resources and also the recycling. This is the whole summary of the RE resources as on today. And as you know, the carbonatites will have more amount of almost 62% of the RE in the whole deposits, and then followed by the alkaline igneous rocks and the placer deposits and ion absorption deposits like that. And if you look at the global distribution of RE deposits, all over the world you have deposits. In fact, you look at the ion absorption type RE deposits, alkaline complex hosted RE deposits, then carbonatite hosted RE deposits, placer deposits, you have all over the world. But these are the economically viable and exploitable RE deposits in the world today. The Wang et al. Reported in 2020, just a year back, not even a year back. This is a famous, Bayanobo is a famous company, and also Mountain Pass in the United States is also. And in India, the Ambadongar is probably more economically viable, and a lot of other deposits. So these are the major deposits, very recent paper, 2020 only. So this gives a picture of the potential of rare earth elements. And people are working day and night on the find out the of RE deposits, and also new ways to locate untapped RE deposits. For example, this paper is published only in 2020. They have found that phyllite, iron silicate, in fact, iron rich end member of the olivine solid solution series, the mineral, which is a reddish brown and reddish brown to black in color, is mainly mined to use as a gemstone and also used for sandblasting. The phyllite can be found almost entire world in igneous rocks and abyssal rocks. This phyllite incorporates HREE, and which is a very really potential source for locating the new deposits. If you see, if you are able to find out that phyllite is in your rock, there is a chance that you have a RE deposit somewhere there. And this is a case study after the Mountain Pass. This is only a second deposit. USA is working. This is the place is called La Paz, which is in Arizona state. And the Mountain Pass and La Paz are about 200 miles or something like that. It's not, they are not very far, though they are situated in two different states, California and Arizona. In fact, there's some company, American Rare Earths company called, the name of the company is American Rare Earths. They have started this exploration, and 9 crore boreholes they have drilled, ranging anywhere between 68 to 122 meters. And they have also put a cutoff grade of about 300 ppm of REE, and they have produced about 4,500 kg of the samples, and 682 meters of core, and they transported that material to the chemical laboratory in Nevada. Following the assay, some crucial samples were selected, and they were sent to Perth laboratory in Western Australia. In fact, their objective is to confirm the extremely shallow resources drilled to an average depth of about only 30 meters with a cutoff grade of 300 ppm of REE, seek higher grades of premium value scandium, rare earths and magnet metals, and heavy REE, which were identified in the surface sampling program, averaging about 552. So it is going to be a potential deposit after Mount Pass for USA. This is only a very recent case. In fact, the drilling started only in March, about 3-4 months back. And again, people are trying to, a lot of groups are understanding, trying to understand how these deposits are formed. This gentleman, Annenberg et al., have discovered a new hypothesis to predict where the rare earth elements could be found. A series of experiments that showed that sodium and potassium, rather than earlier people believed that chloride and fluoride were the crucial elements to make the rare earth elements soluble in carbonatites. But that was not the case. It is the sodium and potassium which are responsible to make RE soluble in solution and get precipitated along in the carbonatites. So the it's not the chlorine bearing solution. Now people are looking at sodium potassium. So like that, lots of new theories. I just gave one example. Lots of new theories are coming up. Then from the supply chain, the supply chain from mining to the end products, for example, exploration, mining, milling, hydrometallurgy, separation, then refining, you get the powders of individual metals, and then these are the various applications. In all these activities, accurate and precise chemical analysis of rare earth elements are required in different metals. So we will now learn about those, what are those techniques. For example, the chemical characterization of by XRF. XRF, you have both the WD XRF, wavelength dispersive XRF, and energy dispersive XRF techniques, which are very successfully applied so far for the determination of rare earth elements in geological as well as environmental samples. And unfortunately, the detection limits are not great compared to other techniques like ICP AES or ICP MS. But you see, you don't require sample preparation. Sample preparation is very minimum. So some of those advantages make this particular technique as an attractive one. And neutron activation analysis. Neutron activation analysis is really very, very sensitive. It can go down to ppb levels, even sub ppb levels. But the only problem is you need to have a reactor. Not only the counting laboratory, you need to have a reactor for irradiation. So that in India, we have only, for the whole country, we have only one reactor at BRC. So particularly for exploration purpose, this particular technique, you need the data immediately. Whereas INA takes for some time to irradiate the sample, then you need to cool it down to get the radioactivity at a handling level. Then you need to count in the laboratory. So it is a time consuming procedure, which is not really suitable for the exploration studies. And this is actually, this laboratory is in Sao Paulo in Brazil, and my collaborator, Professor Ana Maria. I went to this laboratory, spent some time, analyzed my samples. Some of the core samples, some of the crust samples we collected from the Indian Ocean, I analyzed them. You can see the rare earth element data generated by the neutron action. Despite that, it's very slow technique. It's a really very good technique, particularly for theoretical studies, the research and development studies. You can very well use this technique. Then comes ICP AES. So, which was in fact invented only in 1964-65, about 55 years back, this instrument was invented. And you can see the yttrium peak, the emission peak over here, the standard peak and sample peak. It gives good data and very fast. Only problem is, because of the emission spectra of rare earths are, because these are inner transitional elements, emission spectra is very complicated, and lots of interferences of even inter rare earth element interferences also there. So as a result, you need to have a separation procedure before you take and measure it on the ICP AES. So it's not really very fast, but it's independent. You don't have to depend on a reactor or anything. in the laboratory, if you deploy a number of people, this can be also a faster technique. Then MPAES. MPAES means microwave plasma atomic emission. This instrument was only developed in 2012. It's not even 10 years old. It's just 10 years, one decade old. And I can proudly say that myself and my group people at NGRI are the first users of this instrument in India. We have developed lots of procedures for the not only rare earth elements but also other elements in several types of samples. And in recent times, I have also in 2020, I have also published a review paper on this in Microchemical Journal, an Elsevier journal, which has started receiving lots of citations these days. This is a potential technique for rare earth elements. The advantage here is, see, it doesn't require any gas. Microwave plasma operates on nitrogen gas, which is taken from the surrounding environment using a nitrogen generator. So all you need is only a power to run this instrument. You don't require any cylinders, no regulators, no gas connections, no lines, etc. And the sensitivity is more or less equivalent to ICP-OES. So it is an active, and the same kind of interference problems what we have for ICP-AES, also there for MPAES. In fact, you have to, this gentleman is Eric Hoffman. He's, of course, he's no more. A few years back, he expired. But I met him about 9 years back at 34th International Geological Congress in Brisbane, Australia. And he has Actalabs. Actalabs, everybody knows, it's a famous laboratory which was started in Canada. I also happened to visit that lab in Canada, near Ancaster, near Niagara Falls. And this man has several branches all over the world, Africa, Australia, Canada, Central and South America, Europe, Mongolia, etc. So the thing why I'm showing this slide is, I had a chart with on the potential of MPAES for the mineral exploration. He said, wherever there are no power supply, I mean the proper gas supply, particularly in remote places like Australia and South America, I have deployed MPAES and they are working extremely well. They are helping our exploration studies, he said. So because there is no requirement for gas, so if you, only requirement is power. So in remote locations and also on the mobile laboratory, this MPAES can work. Then comes quadrupole ICP-MS. You see, these are the peaks, the rare earth element peaks. It's very simple. In fact, if you have 100, there were number of days actually on which we started dissolving 100 samples during the daytime. By evening 4 o'clock, we get all the solutions ready, and then we start analyzing on the quadrupole ICP-MS for rare earth elements. By 9 o'clock or 8:30, 9 o'clock, the data, all the 16 or 14 or 16 elements, all the rare, also some, a lot of other elements, including all rare earth elements for 100 samples, is made ready by 9 o'clock. If you get the sample in the morning, 10 o'clock or 9:30, by 9 o'clock, in 12 hours, you have data ready. You don't require any ion exchange separations or solvent extraction separations. Directly, you dissolve 100 mg or 50 mg of the sample, make it to 100 ml or 200 ml, then aspirate into ICP-MS, you get extremely good data. See, the good data can be comparable with those of other established techniques like Newton activation analysis, Parkes mass spectrometry, ICP-AES, etc. This is the data presented here for the NOD A1 and P1. A polymetallic nodule sample collected from Pacific Ocean and polymetallic nodule sample collected from the Atlantic Ocean. These two samples were made standards by the USGS. There are certified values available. So we always try to check by running these samples as an unknown and then see whether we are getting the values correctly or not. Then comes time of flight ICP-MS. Our group is the first in this country to do the rare earth element analysis using ICP time of flight MS. And we don't have it at our institute, but we have this instrument at Manuguru heavy water plant in Telangana. So I used that and then produced rare earth element data in number of cobalt crust or marine crust samples. Then comes the high resolution ICP-MS and multicolor ICP-MS. So these are the people who is responsible for the development of Bradshaw. And Fredman is one of the pioneering scientists of England. He developed the multicolor ICP-MS. Currently, I'm engaged in the writing of a review article on multicolor ICP-MS and its application in environmental and geological sciences. So this is the paper which we published in Indian Journal of Marine Sciences on our high resolution ICP-MS, which is deployed at NGRI. This is the rare earth element chemistry of the seawater from Afanasy Nikitin Seamount in North Central Indian Ocean by high resolution ICP-MS, which we published in 2015, about 6 years back. So this is the, what is the advantage of high resolution ICP-MS when compared to the quadrupole ICP-MS? The quadrupole ICP-MS is, for example, the praseodymium oxide 141 and 16. Praseodymium 141 and 16 means 157. This peak, this molecular ion peak directly overlaps with that of gadolinium 157. So as a result, in quadrupole ICP-MS, you get higher values because you are adding some of the praseodymium also to the gadolinium. So the ICP-MS values the quadrupole ICP-MS values obtained by gadolinium are not correct in general. Sometimes you may get good data, but in general are not correct. So because of this particular interference, there are a lot of other interference, but this is a prominent interference. So that's why I'm showing this. You can see the same sample using high resolution ICP-MS and quadrupole ICP-MS. See, the gadolinium values are slightly higher. Actual correct values are obtained by high resolution ICP-MS. And these are also not very bad, but slightly higher. That is because of this. So that's why today, if you ask me which is the best technique, I say that high resolution ICP-MS is the best technique for rare earth elements. This is the latest paper, high resolution ICP-MS and the determination of rare earth elements, not only rare earth elements, platinum group of elements and other trace elements. So this paper, which we published in 2018, about 3 years back, received already 51 citations so far. And I told you about the multicolor ICP-MS. Multicolor ICP-MS is mainly for the determination of isotopic ratios. It may be rare earth elements, isotopic ratios, or samarium, neodymium, or rubidium, strontium, whatever. And also, we can determine the elemental composition also using MC-ICP-MS very accurately when compared to the high resolution, because this is an expensive machine and you have number of detectors simultaneously recording the different ions coming towards the detector. On the other hand, the thermal ionization mass spectrometry, which we also have at NGRI, both instruments we have at NGRI. This is also used for rare earth elements, not only for the rare earth elemental isotopic ratios, but also for the accurate determination using isotope dilution technique, this particular instrument, TIMS, called thermal ionization mass spectrometry, is used very extensively. And now with the laser ablation, you see for certain, for example, this iron silicate phyllite, it's not very easily dissolved. So you can determine the heavy rare earth elements using in the phyllite mineral using laser ablation high resolution ICP-MS. I worked for some time when I was at Iowa State University in 2009. So this is the NIST glass standard. This is the rare earth element area, in fact. So this is one of the best technique where you don't have to dissolve your sample. For example, some of the samples like zircon, it's very difficult to dissolve. If you want to determine the rare earth elements in zircon mineral, this is the best technique. And then SIMS, secondary ion mass spectrometry. This is an age-old technique and very expensive technique. We can also use this particular technique for the determination of not only rare earth elemental isotope ratios, but also rare earth elemental concentrations. And atom probe tomography. This is an instrument by which, in fact, the people have confirmed the presence of higher heavy rare earth elements in the phyllite crystal lattice. Using that only, they could come out that the phyllite mineral can be an indicator mineral for the rare earth element deposits, resources rather. So this is one of the techniques. And SHRIMP, sensitive high resolution ion microprobe, is one of the most expensive instrument, costs more than 20 crores or something like that. He is Professor William Comston of Australian National University, is the inventor of this technique. In fact, later on, they have given this technology to the Australian Scientific Company, and which supplied lots of instruments to all over the country. In fact, I happened to receive an award called Eminent Mass Spectroscopist Award from him at an international conference in Munnar in Kerala. Later on, I was invited to his department where I spent some time, gave a talk to the colleagues of the School of Earth Sciences in 2006. If you compare the detection limits by some of the popular instrumental analytical techniques for the rare earth elements, you can see the WDXRF, LIBS, which we will talk in the coming slides, MPAES, INAA, Instrumental Neutron Activation Analysis, ICPOES, GDMS. GDMS is another technique, low discharge mass spectrometry, which we have not in fact talked. It's not really very popular. The laser ablation ICP-MS, normal ICP-MS, ICP time of flight mass spectrometer, and high resolution ICP-MS. So undoubtedly, high resolution ICP-MS is the most sensitive and most interference-free for the determination of rare earth elements. And if you look at the usage of different techniques by the rare earth element characterization, ICP-MS occupies nearly 60% of the data generation, followed by ICP-OES and neutron activation analysis and XRF. So ICP-MS is really very popular for the rare earth elements, as I have been telling you. And today's trend is to use the portable, field portable analytical instruments in mineral exploration. Sometime back, about 4 years back, I published an article in Journal of Applied Geochemistry on the field portable analytical instrumentation in mineral exploration. So all these instruments, handheld XRF, handheld LIBS, handheld spectrophotometer, handheld Raman spectrometer, handheld infrared spectrometer, and also a portable arc spark optical emission spectrometer. These are the, you can take them to the field, in fact. You can put them in your pocket, take it to the field, and then and there you don't have to bring the samples to the laboratory. So you are taking the instrument to the field. For the first time in 2007, when I visited the South Africa University of Pretoria in South Africa, I analyzed a Marinisky reef, a chromite reef, and it just took 25 seconds to get this data. See the chromium 23%, vanadium 0.2%, and thallium 0.5%. The balance is 62%. To get this data, it just took only 25 seconds by this instrument, which is also a computer controlled instrument. In fact, the portable XRF is doing, I know a lot of companies are using, the exploration companies are using this portable XRF, because in the field itself, you cannot really afford to make any mistake. And this instrument also will not allow you to make any mistake, because it can identify the elements of your interest in the field itself. By use of a portable XRF in the exploration, and also specialty elements like rare earth elements, niobium, zirconium, tantalum, they have achieved varying degree of successes. And then portable XRF is capable of analyzing elements from magnesium to uranium. Unfortunately, lithium and beryllium are not in this range, and the XRF cannot analyze lithium and beryllium, but all other elements can be analyzed. And particularly, this is really very good for these elements like cobalt, chromium, copper, iron, etc. And also calcium, aluminum and potassium, rubidium, bismuth, etc. But it's not really very good for magnesium and phosphorus and other elements like mercury, cadmium, etc. And if you look at the detection limits, see, particularly you look at the detection limit of lanthanum, 30 to 50, cerium 45 to 60, praseodymium 65 to 100, neodymium 75 to 360. Here we have to remember one thing: you are not diluting the rock. See, if you bring the sample and do by ICP-MS, you take about 50 mg or 100 mg of the sample, dissolve it and make it to 100 ml. Means 1000 times you are diluting your sample. If you have 1 ppm of a rare earth element, in your solution it is only 1 ppb. But here you are not diluting your, so even with these detection limits, you can really identify the rare earth elements if your rocks have rich RE concentrations. So that is the point one has to remember. Then LIBS, where I said this portable XRF cannot detect lithium and beryllium, this LIBS, laser ionization breakdown spectroscopy, this is also handheld spectroscopy. And this particular instrument can very well determine lithium. Lithium is why I'm talking about lithium. Lithium is a hot metal these days. All our batteries, all our cars, whatnot, every mobiles, then the laptops, etc., the batteries, you need lithium. So for exploration of lithium, this is the best machine, best instrument. You can identify in the field itself. You can, for example, rare earth elements, you see neodymium concentration. These are the standards, and this is the signal of the instrument, and you get an extremely very good calibration curve. In addition, the core scanners, they are made by using the technologies of XRF, LIBS, and visible light, and also near infrared spectroscopy. The LIBS is a promising technology for the fast detection of enriched areas in drill core samples. RE are sometimes difficult to measure due to weak emission lines, but several authors showed that examples for successful detection of number of different RE in different geological materials. The detection limits are often in ppm range for most elements in the periodic table, and as I have given here, and also depends on the matrix. So particularly for rare earth elements as well as lithium. This is a very good field tool. And you know very well, the Geological Survey of India was very successful with its national geochemical sampling program, mapping program. And they have, I think they have generated maps for the entire country for several elements, maybe 60, 70 elements. Using those maps, these people, if they have discovered a sporadic very high RE anomalous zones in northwest, southeast trending Pranahita, Godavari, Gondwana basin towards the northeastern fringe of Telangana. So the total REE content in the area was approximately 7,000 ppm. So I think it's going to be a very good deposit. I just accidentally got this information. And I've been telling lots of geochemical methods. This particular hello. The power of geochemical methods. This slide will demonstrate the power. And the soil survey, bedrock surveys, stream sediment surveys, biogeochemistry, hydrogeochemistry, and soil gas studies. The geochemical methods means all these are included. These geochemical methods have played an important role in the discovery of 870 new mineral deposits in China during 1981 to 2000, nearly 20 years. They have discovered 817 deposits, and out of those 817 deposits, the geochemical methods helped in 71%, and geophysical methods 19%, and others 10%. So that shows the power of geochemical mineral exploration methods. So these are some of the, I was telling you about my 2019 paper, which is I think within a span of 2 years, it crossed 250 citations. So very well cited. Even in the journal homepage, you will see that most downloaded and most cited paper. This is my latest paper on the ICP-MS. It's a review paper, Strategies to Overcome Interferences in Elemental and Isotopic Geochemical Analysis by Quadrupole Inductively Coupled Plasma Mass Spectrometry, a Critical Evaluation of the Recent Developments, which is published in Rapid Communications in Mass Spectrometry very recently. This is the book chapter edited by these gentlemen from the University of Ireland. Entitled Sources and Sustainable Technologies for the Efficient Rare Earth Element Recovery, in which my chapter's title is Rare Earth Elements Resources and Applications, which is coming up. So recently, I also wrote a message in the book published by my friend from IIT, Devshish Sen Gupta and others. This is a paper, which is a 60-page paper, gives you the total geochemical analysis, starting from spectrophotometry to the high-resolution ICP-MS or SHRIMP analysis. 60-page, very recently published. In fact, in print, it came only two months back, in May. This is on the environmental problems related with the use of rare earth elements. A chapter which I collaborated with scientists from maybe about eight or ten countries from four continents: North America, South America, Europe, and Asia. This is a 110-page chapter which has been just published. This is a guest editorial which I published in the month of April 2021 in the Journal of Geological Society of India, just a few months back. 2-3 months back. So coming to the conclusions, fast emerging green technologies ranging from electric car batteries to solar panels to wind turbines are expected to drive tremendous growth and demand for RE in near future. Greater need to intensify our search for RE resources, not only on land, but also in the ocean bottom sediments. Deep sea mining would definitely be a feasible option in near future, in addition to cost-effective recovery of REE from the abundant coal and coal ash. Great need for developing a sustainable exploitation schemes for all kinds of REE ore deposits and meticulously follow to prevent further damage to the environment. Instead of opening new mining ventures, extraction of REE from the coal-fired ash and electronic recycling schemes are considered the promising options for near future RE supply. In future, geochemistry with labs as well as portable instruments will play a greater role in finding out hidden mineral deposits, especially the rare earth elements deposits. So I'm thankful to Mr. Karunakar Rao Garu, founder and the president of the Data Core, and his colleagues, Dhruv Jyotinath, Mr. Vikas Piru, and Mr. Abhishek Sen. I wish all of the people who are listening to this all the best and a glorious future. So this is the talk. Now we can have a kind of a question answer session now.
Yeah, sure, sir. Sir, thank you. Let me just thank you for such a resourceful, knowledge enhancing session.
Thank you.
Geological formation to determination to mining value chain, as well as all the laboratorial analysis that is required. So I'm sure many of us would be having a lot of questions on RE. So I would request everyone, if at all, if you have any questions, you can write in the chat box. Or you can just raise your hand, we can put your video on and unmute you. So I think there will be questions coming up. So I just had a question, I had a couple of questions I wanted to ask you.
Okay.
Yeah, sir, you also said that iron oxide is the primary deposit.
Iron oxide. I'll just go back to my slide.
So in that you said only in pyrolite there has been occurrence. So is there any other minerals of iron oxide?
Pyrolite. It shows a definite presence of your RE mineral. Yeah, iron oxide copper gold deposits, they are called IOCG deposits. So okay. They are one class of deposits, not alone iron oxide.
Okay. So it's a class of deposits.
Yeah. And iron oxide, that iron silicate, pyrolite, is an indicator mineral for rare earth elements.
Okay. And so one more thing I wanted to ask you is there any, in any of your papers or any of the studies, any environmental hazards that has been linked with this RE deposit?
Yeah, a lot. Malaysia, China. In fact, in my paper, I have very clearly written lots of problems with rare earth element exposure. Lots of health problems for the community who are living by the mining area, and the water gets sometimes contaminated with rare earth elements, which we have actually dealt in our recent paper also, in collaboration with people from other countries. Unfortunately there is no regulation on the rare earth elements, and they have not also given the cutoff concentration for the rare earth elements in water, drinking water, the World Health Organization has not given any. People are working on it. People have no idea. Now people started working on rare earth elements as well as PGE, platinum group of elements, on the cutoff values for these elements in drinking water. Uranium, you know very well, they have given. There are a lot of lead, mercury, like that we have values. Means this particular value we should not cross in drinking water. Like that, unfortunately, we don't have a rare earth element and also for platinum group of elements. And then now people are working, and very soon I'm sure that you'll have stringent measures in cutting down these elements in the rare earth elements or platinum group elements are not the problems in normal cities, but is only the mining areas, the villages around and towns around mining areas where the water gets contaminated by these elements in higher values, and they create problems. Okay.
Atul
has one question. Atul, go ahead, please.
Am I audible now?
Yes.
I am Atul Pandey from Department of Geology, Patna University. I have a question, like Professor Balaram, he has mentioned about the concentration of RE in fluvial sediments.
Yes.
So my question is, considering the vast geographical the Himalayan rivers or the rivers draining in the cratonic mass of our country, where we can expect more concentration of RE, and which should be the thrust area?
In fact, the Himalayan, I have given the values for the Himalayan rivers. If I am correct, I'll just go back to my slides and get back to you to your question. Yes, this one. The Himalayan, I have compared Himalayan and Amazon river sediments showing 150 to 217 ppm. At the moment, those sediments may be uneconomical. It's not very easy to extract RE from those less concentrated raw material. But in future, once the rare earth element values, I mean, the cost increases and also the technology comes to for a easy extraction, so probably at that time only those material can become valuable. But now it is just a matter of subject interest.
Okay, thank you. Actually, we in the state of Bihar, we are very much concerned about the sediments which are coming from the Himalayan terrain.
And most of
the North Bihar plains, the volume and bulk of the sediments, it is lying in fact, from the RE point of view, it is unutilized as such. We would like to collaborate and we can have any sort of study in the Indo-Gangetic plain of our state. So we may
Definitely. NGRI will always come forward for collaboration. You can just write to me, I will guide you how to proceed.
Okay, thank you, sir.
His question is, handed X-ray gives accurate results for gold and base metal because there is a lot of noise. I'm not able to hear you. Once more, please.
Sorry for that, sir.
Yeah. Please come start. Yeah,
this question was whether handheld X-ray gives accurate results for gold and base metal concentration, because he has found in the PPT that is excellent for some minerals and very poor performance to know the concentration. Like as in one of your PPT, you had mentioned that it shows very poor concentration for silver, magnesium, and phosphor. So you wanted to know whether gold and base metal concentration can be found out from this handheld X-ray.
See, handheld XRF is not that sensitive to find out gold in the field. See, instead, you have to follow the pathfinder elements like arsenic, etc. Supposing you have 10 ppm of gold, it can be detected. But you have 1 ppm or 2 ppm. Even 1 ppm or 2 ppm to find itself is very difficult. Normally, rocks contain only ppb levels. That's the reason that handheld XRF cannot detect gold in normal rocks. That is the reason people use handheld XRF for detecting the pathfinder elements like arsenic, etc. Even for PGE, you go and detect magnesium, chromium, cobalt, etc. So they are the pathfinders for PGE. But luckily, if you get a rich, the PGE or gold rich rock, definitely it will be, it can be detected. You understood?
Yeah.
It's not a precision measurement. It is only a semi-quantitative indication by handheld XRF.
Sir, we have a question from two of our participants, Swati and
yes.
Remember, both of them something similar. Swati wants to know, are there any prominent surface indicators for RE deposit? And Upendra also, in a similar way, he wants to know that which are the host rock we should look at so that we can have a more success story, especially with respect to Indian continent.
I think I have to confess that I really don't have much experience on practical aspects of the RE exploration. But surface, you may not find anything. From the host rock only you have to. That's what I think.
I take this pleasure to thank all the participants on behalf of DataCode. Abhishek will give a vote of thanks. Abhishek, please.
Distinguished guests, dear participants, on behalf of DataCode and organizing team of Partners in Progress, I feel immense pleasure to ask or propose a vote of thanks to our today's speaker, Dr. V. Balaram, who has relevantly addressed the issue or we can say the application, occurrence, exploration and chemical characterization of rare earth elements in today's session, who has spared his time from his busy schedule to grace this webinar. And I would like to thank and show our regards and gratitude to Mr. Karunakar Rao, our president, who has continuously encouraging us and supporting us to organize such an event. I would like to take the opportunity to heartily thank our vice president, Mr. Dhruva Jyoti Nath, and our principal geoscientist, Mr. Vikas Piru, who has continuously encouraging us and shown their confidence on us. At last, but not the least, all the participants who chose to be live with us in today's session, and they have shown their enthusiasm and cooperation in this session to make this session successful and cooperative. And before concluding the session, I would heartily thank Dr. Nausad Haq sir, who is also present in this session and who will be our next presenter or speaker for our next session, which will be held in 14th of August 2021 on the topic of recovery of rare earth elements from secondary resources. And Haq sir is present with us. And before concluding the session, I would like to ask Dr. Haq, if you could add anything or any point for this session, it will be great pleasure for us to hear from you. So over to you, Harsh sir, and then we'll thank all the participants and conclude the session. Harsh sir.
Sir, you are on mute.
Sir, please unmute yourself, sir.
Yeah, go ahead, sir.
We can hear you.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
No?
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can.
Yes. Okay, sorry. I had a bit of issues, looks like. So, yeah, thanks for organizing this. I enjoyed the presentation by Dr. Balaram. And, yeah, I think in Australia, I work for CSIRO. So, essentially, rare earth is becoming a hot topic and all the countries are working, and there are a lot of new initiatives between India and Australia. So I'm looking forward to this session and would like to present a book chapter we have published recently on rare earth from secondary resources. So looking forward to you on 14th of August, I think. Is that 14th of August, I guess? Yeah, that's right. Yeah. So please fix that day, a time, and let me know. So I will be making myself available for that time.
Definitely. Thank you.
Thank you all.
All the participants, this presentation will be available to you on our website later, after some time. And we will send you a mail to when once we make it available. Thank you for participation.
Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thanks, Karunakara Garu. Thanks. And your team.
Yes, thank you, sir. Thank you.